Hi, everybody, and away we go with another edition of the Stampede Wrestling Show. I'll tell you, we've got some bouts this time around that I think are going to excite you, not the least of them being Owen Hart returning after 3 weeks on the injury shelf. He goes against Jerry Morrow. Mukka Singh takes on Colonel Kirchner. Colonel Kirchner, he's had a promotion. In the main event, Brian Pillman and Bruce Hart for the International Tag Team belts against Jason the Terrible and the Zodiac. So batten down the hatches, lock the door. It is indeed Stampede against Bip Wellington. And we are nearing the 10-minute mark. Jürgen Hermann giving a few instructions here to Parts, who has been surprisingly ugly. Jeff Parts, his father. Boy, he was popular in this area. I wonder if he's trained his son. If he has. It's not in the proper ways of the Marquess of Queensbury. Not at all. This is a 15-minute time limit. Wellington with a few problems.
Well, if legendary wrestler Jeff Parts did train his son Garfield, it certainly wasn't in table manners. His table manners must be the equivalent of Garfield the cat in those cartoons, and I'll tell you what else. His manners in the ring are no better. He was telling the crowd when they were getting on his case to shut up. Obviously, not an entire gentleman despite good breeding lines from London, England.
Not as cute as the real Garfield either, is he? Jürgen Hermann has had all he could handle in this one, primarily because of the antics of Mr. Port. Look out! Oh, he ran into trouble again. We note that Kerry Brown is back in the territory. We hope to see, although I don't know if he has arrived as yet, Timothy Flowers reporting for action here. And Ports, of course, is making his debut.
Another person that we will see probably during the course of this show is a manager, a very strange little cigar-smoking character who I have finally found out his actual identity. He is, in fact, a Middle East character who's coaching the Karachi Vice crew. His name, Abu Weasel. Abu Weasel, perhaps.
Well, now, what an investigative reporter you have turned out to be. Okay, let's watch Biff going to work. Gets a good slam in there with the elbow, goes to the midsection. Wellington coming back very strongly. The crowd giving him all sorts of encouragement. And he is handling Ports, who has been tough to handle. It's a one, it's a two, that's all.
Wellington, undoubtedly the most improved wrestler in the territory. He is a good one, but he has to somehow cope with some of the tactics of young Garfield Ports. And Ports now pouring on the pressure. It is, in fact, is it a submission? Is it a submission?
Yes, it is. The bell is rung, and the decision is going to go to Garfield Ports, who has not made a particularly impressive debut, not in the minds of the fans in this arena. Well, we can get him over here, and he'll quit yelling at the crowd. I want you to know that I knew your father very well, and I must assume from your behavior, you left home when you were very young.
Well, let's
he didn't have any
let's
influence
get the record
on you.
Straight. Let's get the record straight. I'm here for one reason, and one reason only, and that's to carry on the great reputation of all the great British wrestlers. Because let me tell you, you lot out there have got this great Commonwealth in a sorry state of affair. The first thing I'm gonna get is that Commonwealth title. And I'm not here to make any friends. So get that straight.
I think you're gonna succeed in that, in not making friends, I mean.
I don't wanna make friends, I'm here to make money. I'm here to get titles. I'm not here to make friends, let's get that right straight. Did you hear me on that?
All right. Give my regards to your dad.
Sure.
Yeah, sure.
Well, Owen Hart, the North American heavyweight champ, and it's good to have you in the ring back again tonight. And I'll tell you what, everybody is wondering the extent of the injury, the leg injury that you had. Are you going to be able to be anywhere near 100% tonight when you're going against the champagne man, Jerry Morrow?
Well, my knee's a little bit sore still, but we'll find out tonight when I step in the ring just how good it will be. But I've been working out on it, and it's slowing me up, but I think when I get in the ring and get my adrenaline flowing and I get the crowd here behind me, that this little injury now I'll forget about and give it 100% in the ring.
Okay, obviously, you're no big fan of Jerry Morrow and his tactics. How would you describe your opponent?
Well, I know Jerry Morrow's tough. He's ranked highly in the ratings here, but see, Jerry Morrow, you came out and you challenged me. I didn't challenge you. You guys were breaking the rules. All I did was do a little bit of fair justice last week. But you came out and you challenged me. You said that you're going to get rid of me. You're going to break my neck. You're going to break my leg. Well, Jerry Morrow, come on out and take your best shot. You know, talk is cheap. I do my talk in the ring with my fist, Jerry Morrow. So you can go and talk about what you're going to do to me on a microphone. But when we step in the ring, it's a different story. So we'll see what you got to offer and you and me square off in the ring. And I just got one other thing to say. Jason the Terrible, who's been going out on these terrorizing trips. He's been beaten, brutalizing all these wrestlers. And,
last week he put Hirohashi out of business.
Well, he put him in a wheelchair. And that's the kind of stuff that I'm sick and tired of seeing. And I don't want to see that stuff going on in these rings of professional wrestling. So Jason the Terrible, you put Chris Benoit down, you put Hirohashi down, and now Jason the Terrible, if you got enough guts to face me, I'll tell you what, you come and take your best shot to put me down, Jason the Terrible, because this thing's been building up. You, guys like you and Muk and Singh, it's been building up on and on and on. So Jason the Terrible, you're just another guy on, you're another notch on my peg, and you step in the ring, I'll put you down.
North American heavyweight.
The efforts of Dandy Randy. Going for a ride. He ducked under. Caught him nicely with a drop kick. Hits him again, knocks him down. Good action there. And look at the strength of the kid. Hey, he's looking all right.
Nothing the matter with Regina boys. Being one myself, I can tell you, they grow them tough on the prairies in Saskatchewan. Something to do with those long, hard winters. Look at Randy Thatcher firing Kerry Brown into the turnbuckle, laying on the punishment. Whoa!
Uh-oh. That big clothesline really shook up the kid. Kerry loading up that elbow. Bango. One, two, three. It's over. Kerry Brown returns triumphantly to the territory. Well, I am not sure if Jason the Terrible and the Zodiac are getting along. They seem to have had some problems, but let's switch you to another studio, and I don't know, maybe we'll find out.
Long enough, and now it is time for the gold to go to the flesh.
Well, there you go, Jason and friend, I think. We got a cast of thousands here. Bad news, Alan, my main man who makes me nervous at times.
Let me tell you something, King Edward, and let me tell these beer belly sharecroppers one thing. I signed an open contract to meet either that Kirshner or that little young punk lollipop sucker who calls himself the North American heavyweight champ, Pee-wee the Hart Herman. But neither one of them have got the guts or the gall to sign their name. They went out and they recruited this Johnny Smith, who has totally no brains because he seemed to have forgotten the lesson that I taught him the last time he stepped into the square circle with the Ultimate Warrior. And I do not intend to wrestle again in this ring until I get either one of them with their chicken scratch on a contract to meet me. I'm 4 times North American heavyweight title holder, and I don't intend to go down and beat up on nobody else until I get those two idiots in the ring here. I don't care if it's one at a time or both at the time, it doesn't matter. But if they got the gall and the guts to put their name there, I will be here to meet them. Until that time, that's when you'll see me in this ring wrestling.
I think he's on strike. I think he's on
that's
strike.
That's right, I'm on strike.
That's right, Will. And let me tell you something, Eddie. I'm really upset. The people seeing the Champagne Man and myself get ripped off last week by Tinkerbell and Little Pillman. The people seeing the belt stole from us, they know it was a misjustice. I'm going to jump in the same boat as Alan. I can only gear my motives and all my time to championship matches. I'm tired of clowning around. I won't even mention the little idiot I'm going to wrestle tonight. He can't make up his mind what rank he is, if he's a corporal, a colonel, a private. You know, I don't think he was ever in the service.
He's tough.
That so-called bag he carries around, I think that's actually a big garbage bag. And during the week, he goes from trash can to trash can, picking out cans and bottles. That's all he does. The closest he was ever to the service was maybe seen reading a G.I. Joe comic book or something. That's the closest he ever was. Oh. Another historic year just went by, Ed. Another historic year. Calgary, no Grey Cup.
All right, all right. 20 minutes, we're about the 10-minute mark. Just got a lap full of DeSalvo. He missed. Trying to hit Johnny Smith. And he just about got Jim Davies.
DeSalvo is furious. He grabbed the ringside table, slammed it down onto the floor after picking it up. He is irate. Strangler Steve DeSalvo, you don't want to get him upset.
Well, he is a little ornery tonight. Johnny Smith missed. Smith caught him nicely up. He pulled his knee. He ran into a knee problem. Here comes the Mongolian again. Well, off those ropes, he's a big man. Cover one, two, that's off, as Smith kicks out with a vengeance.
Keep in mind there's a significant weight advantage for the team of Hashif Khan and the big man Strangler Steve DeSalvo at 290 and 270 respectively. They have approximately 130-pound weight advantage over their opponents.
Well, DeSalvo having a little jawing match with LaFleur. But here's Johnny Smith, pulls him over one. Oh. And that obviously antagonizes Mr. DeSalvo. The Mongolian coming in.
Well, some questionable tactics by Steve DeSalvo and Hashif Khan have put Johnny Smith in big trouble. He has been unable to make a tag for quite some time. He is hurting. He has a knee problem. He has a back problem. It might only be a matter of time if he cannot make a tag with the Montreal sensation, Phil LaFleur.
Well, he's in unfriendly territory in this corner right now. Off those ropes, look out, Nelly! He came over top! A glancing blow, but he didn't knock him down. He made the tag again, but guess what? Again, the referee did not see him. The crowd is not happy.
15 minutes,
we're at the 15-minute mark.
He's going to hang him out to dry, and the Mongolian is coming over top. Oh, that should finish him off. Referee Wayne Hart having more than a normal problem. 2-3, it's all over. The winners, DeSalvo and Kahn. Phil LaFleur, your nerves have got to get a little shattered. Not only were there two legal tags that weren't recognized, but DeSalvo is running. He's running from you.
I just don't understand it. He claims that he's wrestler's strongest men. He's 290 pounds. He has 24-inch arms. What is he doing running away? Not only did he backstab me, smash my trophy, and put stitches in my head. All I want, Ed, it's all I want is, I'm so frustrated right now, I can just grab anything. All I want, Steve DeSalvo, I don't know why. You can't run, and you can't hide forever. One day, you're gonna have to face me. And it's not gonna be no wrestling match. It's gonna be a pure brawl. I don't care if I get you here, outside the ring, in the parking lot, in the alley. We're gonna face each other one day, Steve DeSalvo. And let me tell you, I'm in the best shape of my life right now. And Steve DeSalvo, I'll never, never forget you. I'm calling you a coward, and I hope you're as half as tough as your mouth. Then you might give me a fight. Steve DeSalvo, we're gonna come down to it, and you're gonna be on the losing end.
All right, a frustrated Phil LaFleur.
Strangler Steve DeSalvo is parading around the ring. Steve, I just was listening to an interview from Phil LaFleur. He says you're avoiding him. He wants you in the ring.
Like I have to avoid anyone. Avoid? Mr. LaFleur was running like the typical Frenchman, running all around, trying to stay away. I don't blame him. You know, Mr. LaFleur, I got to give you a little bit of credit. You actually have half a brain, maybe that of half a Neanderthal or Cro-Magnon, but you actually ran for me in the ring. Very, very smart. But Mr. David, I'll tell you what, as long as these fine, upstanding people who love me so much want to see Mr. LaFleur end up in the hospital, I'm the one to accommodate him.
He said that you were avoiding making a tag so that you wouldn't have to face him in the ring in this last tag team bout.
Wait a minute. Did you see that?
I did, in fact, see that.
How many fingers?
2.
You gotta be crazy and you gotta be a retard. Mr. LaFleur, whatever you imagine, this isn't Fantasy Island. Your dreams won't come true. But I'll tell you what, Mr. LaFleur would like a fight?
He would.
I'll accommodate him. What I'm gonna do to Mr. LaFleur, I think he's gotta be possessed. Maybe I could be his exorcist. I could be the great messiah. And Mr. LaFleur, I told you this before. When I take you down, it's not gonna be a 1-2-3. I'm gonna take you down with a pile driver on the concrete. And then I'll pick you up, press you into the ring. And then I'm gonna come down off the top rope. And as you're looking up, and you'll be saying to yourself, God, please help me. But I am God. So in all, what the bottom line is, Mr. LaFleur, and you could take this to the bank, you're gonna be permanently injured. And you, CDs, whatever you want, don't take it in Canadian funds, take it in US funds, because you could take it straight to the bank. You're gonna end up where you're gonna be, never wrestle again.
Strangler Steve DeSalvo, a man of a few words.
Offering the peace pipe to the 260-pound Colonel Kirchner. We're nearing the 10-minute mark. It's one fall with a 30-minute time limit. Crowd says no, no, no. They do not trust Mukesh Singh, and that's rather understandable. Watch. There will be no peaceful coexistence in that ring as far as the Colonel's concerned.
Colonel Kirchner has always said that he doubts the courage of Mukesh Singh. He points to a suspect war record or lack of same by Mukesh Singh. And right now, although Mukesh Singh just grabbed the upper hand in this bout thus far, and we are approaching the 10-minute mark, it has been Mukesh Singh who does not want to mix it up with the Colonel.
Well, this is the first time of the fight that Mukesh Singh has had the advantage, but he's pressing to it now.
see Conum coming off those ropes, did he not? Two count, that's all. I'm waiting for the man from Fort Bragg to get his motor in gear, Jim.
Well, as you said earlier, it was all Corporal Kirshner for the first few minutes of this bout, mind you. That was largely because Muck and Singh did not want to mix it up. All I know is that Kirshner is undefeated in singles bouts and that he generally dispatches his opponents in the first 5 minutes.
We've just gone past the 10-minute mark. Bear hug still being applied by Big Mukha Singh. Well, the referee's attention was diverted. And the crowd expressing their disgust to Mukha Singh, and justifiably so. Just two.
This is a shocking development. Colonel Kirshner, I keep forgetting about his military promotion, has never been defeated in the ring. He has always vanquished his opponents with ease. Now he is coming back. Look at him coming off the ropes. Whoa, Mukha Singh paying the price.
Crowd roaring for more, more, more. He's going for a ride. Caught him with that clothesline beautifully. Gives him the elbow. Gonna fly. The paratrooper is going to fly. Has he got him? One, two. Oh, very close, very close.
It is all Colonel Kirshner right now, and at ringside, Abu Wiesel and Miss Honey are looking extremely distraught. They are upset seeing the big 380-pound toilet bowl being thrown around inside that ring. Colonel Kirshner going to work, and he has Mukha Singh hung up on the ropes.
Oh, he's also got the little guy. Look at him, he's hanging him up. He knocks him down. Otto, Otto. Bad news, Allen. Bad news, Allen. Trying to come in there with a yellow paint, I think it was, and it's all over. I don't know that the referee saw Allen.
He did not see Bad News Allen. Bad News Allen in there with that can of yellow spray paint. He had threatened to spray that down the back of the colonel. And while the referee, Wayne Hart, was distracted, the Karachi crunch took place. Mukha Singh wins a very controversial decision. Colonel Kirshner, you were hosed. I saw Bad News Allen come up, distract you. You got the Karachi crunch. A very unpopular decision.
It wasn't a decision at all. All it was a cheap shot, man. Fine, you captured me off guard. You take a 1, 2, 3. You didn't give me that. You didn't get nothing. You got lucky. That's what you got, brother. But you make one mistake when you don't put me out for good, because I keep coming back for more, and I'm going to get you. Because that's all they can do, Jim Davis. That's all you can do, man. Because you can cheat, you run, you can hide. One of you can't beat me. Two of you can't beat me. What's it take? 3, 4? Why don't you hire some more help?
Okay, now this body bag.
I get anything.
This body bag, you want a couple of bodies in there. Obviously, Bad News Allen and Mukha Singh, you want them in that bag.
Allen, you like wearing nice clothes. You're going to look real good in this body bag. You know what this thing's all about? This thing's for casualties. And that's just the way I leave them, man. Lying and dying dead and red. That way I ain't got to worry about them no more. And I'm getting tired of you being a thorn in my side. All I got to say is look out, because the big dog's in town, and I'm gunning for you.
Colonel Kirshner, he's looking for more action
in the combat zone. You got some dues to pay, man. You got some dues to pay.
My main man, I hate to say this, but I think you interfered.
Ed, I think you better get some new prescription in those glasses. The only thing I did was come over here to root my good friend, Macaron.
Well, what's this thing at your hand?
Well, you see this here? Now, he was a buck private or a sergeant or whatever he is. Now he's a colonel or something. The only thing he's going to be is when he signs a contract to get in the ring with the Ultimate Warrior is he's going to be the general of the egg-sucking, beer-belly battalion. That's exactly what he's going to be. I'm going to give him the stripes right down the back because until this day, yellow, because that's what he is, yellow. He has not signed a contract to meet the Ultimate Warrior in the ring here. And it's obvious to me the man is scared and he's afraid. And I see his weakness. Tonight, he lost in the middle here, right to my good friend, Maka Singh. Right in the middle, he beat him 1-2-3.
Well, Maka, you needed help, though.
Hey, I didn't, like you said, Alan come out to cheer me on. Bad news was right there cheering me on. I didn't see him touch Kirshner. I didn't see him touch Kirshner. He went after the manager. He never touched him either. If anybody was going after people that shouldn't have been going after, it was a little potato peel in private. That's what he shouldn't be butting his nose into anything. Let me tell you something. If he ever does have enough guts to jump in the ring with the Ultimate Warrior, bad news, that would be the end of him. And maybe in the same night, what a treat we could give these people, get rid of two babies. Maybe I could get a little Omar to sign a contract with me. I'm coming after you, Omar. You quit hiding, Omar. I see you hiding, peeking around corners. I seen you running. I seen you hiding some more. Get ready, Omar. I don't care when it is or where it is. Just have the belt ready, because we're after championship matches. We're good friends here. We don't care who gets it first.
Unwind?
I don't have to unwind around you.
We got enough of you.
That's
enough of you.
Enough
of you.
Don't worry about it.
Non-title, Owen Hart of Calgary against Jerry Morrow of Martinique, the Champagne Man. One fall, 45-minute time limit. And we've just gone past the 10-minute mark. Right now, it's Morrow in control.
Morrow is in control right at this moment, but if you had the score of the bout, the first 8 minutes were totally dominated by Owen Hart, the North American heavyweight champ, the man ranked number two in the rankings. Champagne Jerry Morrow is now about to get pile-driven. Lamo.
Yes, sir. Owen Hart limping on a bad knee. Oh, man, he caught him in the midsection, getting his knees up just in time. Ooh, I could feel that in my midsection. Just a two count. Hart got the leg up on the ropes. Headbutt, and again the cover, and again Owen Hart has the leg up. Got a problem, though.
He does have a problem, and you can see Jerry Morrow has got some tape or a rope of some sort, and he is now wrapping it around the throat of Owen Hart, concealing it with his arm from referee Jürgen Hermann. This is typical Champagne Jerry Morrow, a man who used to be a clean scientific wrestler who has now turned into the slime that they have grown to love in the forces of Karachi Vice.
He's still choking. The referee cannot see the tape around the throat because Morrow has masked that situation with his arms. Well, Owen Hart in more difficulty than we've seen him in a while. Undoubtedly slowed down by his lack of mobility due to the knee.
Moro gets rid of the tape. And here comes Owen. Oh, he caught a knee going by. Champagne Jerry Moro putting up a spirited bid to defeat Owen Hart. He wants a good shot at that North American heavyweight title. He will get that shot if he defeats Owen in this non-title affair. Whoa! Just got the leg up in time. Hart needs a big rally. Is Moro gonna fly? He is indeed. And it's a long cross-country flight. He's taking too long. He did not take too long. That shocks me. One, two. Oh, an amazing last gasp of strength by Owen Hart. Somehow, he manages to avoid the pin. And now the pressure on the shoulder area by Champagne Jerry Moro. Owen Hart in all kinds of trouble. As you say, Ed Whalen, he has to make a dramatic recovery. The crowd exhorting him to do so. Having more difficulty than I suspected he might against this man. So I suppose in a perverse way, you have to give credit to Jerry Moro. Look at that. Beautiful, pulls him down, slams him, goes up top. Here he goes, Owen Hart. Can he get him now? Pull him down, one, two, oh, so close.
A magnificent athletic maneuver by Owen Hart, who just got distracted by the referee and clubbed from behind. Look at this, Owen Hart. Oh, he's got him, one, two, three. Oh!
Owen Hart, the very popular winner over Jerry Moro. Owen Hart, a sensational victory over Champagne Jerry Moro. I know the knee is bothering you, but the acrobatics that you used to dispatch Moro were indeed amazing.
Well, thanks, Jim. It's definitely a good feeling to come out and on my return back from my injury and be able to beat a guy like Jerry Moro, because he's ranked number two and he is a top wrestler, and it's a big boost for me to be able to beat him. And now I'd just like to say my knee's bothering me a little bit and it's slowing me down a little bit, but with the adrenaline flowing and the people behind me, it sure helps. And now I'm just ready to get back where I left off before I got injured. And I believe I left off with a guy by the name of Jason the Terrible, who was going around beating guys and trying to hurt him. Well, Jason, I'm not 100% yet, but I'll tell you what, I'll make up for that with my determination and my heart. So you step in the ring with me, Jason, and we'll finish off where we left off. And then the rest of you guys, Muck and Singh, don't you ever think that I've forgotten what kind of stuff that you've done to me. And that goes for the rest of these guys, Gamma Singh, Bad News Allen, the whole works here. Come on, because Owen Hart's on fire.
Owen Hart, the North American champ.
Among the champions, international tag team belt holders, facing the challenge of Jason the Terrible and the Zodiac. We're nearing the 15-minute mark now. One fall, 1 hour, and there's a two count as Bruce Hart is struggling at this point in time. 15-minute mark has just been achieved. Tag, and here comes Jason the Terrible. Bruce Hart badly in need of a tag.
He could be very close to a pin. He was almost pinned there. You could score this bout as virtually two different bouts thus far. First 7 or 8 minutes, all Hart and Pillman. Second 7 or 8 minutes, it's been all the Zodiac and Jason the Terrible. And they are in control right now. They have had their differences thus far in the bout.
But right now, they seem aligned with one thing and one thing only in mind, and that is to capture the International Tag Team Championship.
Turn around. Good clothesline by Hart. Can he get over to make the tag? He can't get up to make the tag. The referee isn't looking. There's the tag. The referee was not looking. Oh, my. His attention was diverted. Okay, here we are down on the deck. What happened in the middle of the ring? Look at this. They hit each other. Now they're going after each other. Are you okay?
Well, we both got flattened by Jason the Terrible coming out of the ring.
I'll tell you, I know that the floor is concrete.
This is very, very strange. The bell has sounded. We've got to ask the referee for his decision.
Well, just a minute. What are you doing with the decision?
Bruce Hart win the match from Brian Pillman.
Bruce Hart and Brian Pillman retain the belts. And there was mass confusion, and I must apologize. Part of it was due to the fact I was lying flat on my back on the concrete. But look at in the middle of the ring. What's happening here, Jim?
Well, I mentioned it before. There is bad feeling. You can see that the mentor, the Zodiac, his disciple, Jason the Terrible, is just taking a tongue lashing and some physical abuse from the Zodiac. The Zodiac has him on his knees. This is just absolutely bizarre. These two are supposed to be partners, and now you can see the Zodiac has totally turned on Jason the Terrible. The crowd exhorting Jason the Terrible to get off his knees and lay a beating on the Zodiac.
Jason is not used to hearing the crowd. He's taking off his mask. Now the Zodiac slapping him around. This is totally bizarre. This is bizarre.
You listen to me, you mindless moron.
Oh, he speaks with forked tongue, I think. He's telling the people in the house how mad he is at Jason the Terrible.
Well, he's not earning any support from the crowd by calling them mindless morons and geeks. I'll tell you what, the Zodiac has...
for a sold-out house. Among the celebrated bouts, we will have Bruce Hart and Brian Pillman, the International Tag Team Champions, in action. We also note a great match, I would think, between Mukka Singh and Colonel Kirchner. We have Owen Hart against Hashim Khan. The list goes on. And the biggie, although it is not going to be shown on television, we'll show you the result. Imagine Jason the Terrible against the Zodiac. Brace yourself. We'll be right back. We're looking at Jeff Port's son. That's Garfield Port's, 222 out of London. Johnny Smith. Manchester, Battle of Britain. Well, that's two yellow cards now for Ports. One more, and he's out of here with a disqualification.
Well, I'll tell you what, if he is disqualified, the fans will only be half pleased.
They'd be pleased to see him lose via the disqualification route, but they'd much rather see Johnny Smith, a very popular grappler and former Commonwealth mid-heavyweight champion, beat Garfield Ports 1-2-3 in the middle of the ring.
20-minute time limit. Smith hanging on. Won't get pulled over top. No, sir. The other way. Good maneuvering by Smith. Somebody's going for a ride. Whoa. Ports getting out of there in a hurry. He's gonna fly. He is gonna fly. But he waited too long. Here's Johnny Smith. Joins him in the corner. Gives him a fling. Love it.
Well, that's Air Express. Garfield Ports going flying. He's going off the ropes now. And look at that big clothesline by Johnny Smith. Smith now in control of the bout. Can he put Garfield Ports away?
We may find out shortly, and a power slam just by a slow Ports down. Cover, yes, sir, 1-2, that's all. Oh, a knee drop to the forehead, and this time we've got a different airplane going through space. It's going to be the body of Johnny Smith. The crowd is saying, no, no, no. They're afraid he's going to make a mistake. Is he? Yes, he is. Yes, yes.
Johnny Smith fails in his attempt to ferme la porte.
I can't believe you said that. Put him over, 1. Not quite. The other way, 1-2. Oh, hey. Good action at mid-ring, and Ports is somewhat frustrated that his opponent is doing such a solid job. Well, a low blow.
Well, Garfield Ports is not making himself popular in this territory. That low blow, and now a small package. 1-2-3. It is all over.
I got to say one thing. I hope your father.
I don't care what you're
going to say. I hope your father.
I don't care what you're going to say. Now listen, you Canadian-looking chipmunks, because that's how big your brains are. Listen up to me. Now, I am the greatest athlete ever to come from England, Ireland, Scotland, and Wales, the whole Commonwealth. But I don't have to do this for a living. When I graduated from Oxford.
From Oxford?
I said Oxford. That's right, Oxford. When I graduated from Oxford, with my degree in law.
Law?
With my degree in law, I decided I was going to clean up wrestling, and that's what I'm going to do. I talked to the great Gamma.
How come your halls are illegal?
I don't care. Illegal?
What kind of a lawyer are you?
I never broke any rules. I am strictly a scientific wrestler.
Oh, sure.
Now, you shut up, because I don't care what you're going to say. Now, as I was saying, the great Gamma called me up, and I went first class on the Concorde.
All right.
I dropped Chuck and Die. They got a little bit of trouble right now, and I was sorting it out for them.
All right. Listen, I've had enough of yours. I've had enough of it. We've got other things to do on this show except listen to idiots.
The International Tag Team Champions, Bad Company, that's Bruce Hart and Brian Pillman, and Flying Brian, must feel pretty good to have that belt around the waist once again.
Well, I'm feeling great, Jim, and I understand you were feeling a little ill this week, a little bit under weather. I'm glad to see you're here tonight.
I wouldn't have missed it.
We're going to come out, try to have a nice resounding victory, cheer you up a bit. Let's get the shades on you, brother, because I know there's bright lights up there. It might be hurting your eyes a bit because you're sick. All right, looking good. I think we're taking on Gordy Rogers and Kerry Brown tonight, but I'm not sure. I'm not sure that they're even sure. I think maybe they should call themselves the Great Pretenders. Look at Gordy Rogers. He looks like a cross between Rumpelstiltskin and an anorexic Santa Claus. I mean, have you checked out the guy's wardrobe? It looks like he raided Liberace's closet. And then you got Kerry Brown. I think it might be Meatloaf, that old rock star, moonlighting as a wrestler. Well, this little game of charades sounds a bit fun, so I think tonight, Bad Company is going to assume the role of travel agents. So Rogers and Brown, you got an ETA of about 9:30 tonight. And that A doesn't stand for arrival. That's your estimated time of abuse. Because after Bad Company is done extracting a little sadistic joy on you two, you're going to get a first-class, all-expense-paid, one-way ticket to the promised land.
Okay. Bruce, you can't possibly add much to that.
No, I'd just like to thank all the fans for their cards, letters, and everything else of congratulating us on regaining the belts, you know, and just like to say our fans mean an awful lot to us, especially the young kids and the young adults out there. And during the course of our travels, Brian and I see a lot of them at the schools and at the arenas and all. And one thing that's been on their minds, seems to be a prevalent question in all their minds, is drugs and alcohol. I just like to say all those kids out there, say no to drugs. It's a direct challenge from us to say no to drugs and don't let anybody else lead you down a garden path. Drugs is not the solution to any of your problems whatsoever. So I just like to extend that challenge to all the kids out there to say no to drugs. That's the only way you're going to succeed.
Okay, thanks very much.
I'll reiterate that myself. Be the best you can be. Set your goals high. Say no to drugs.
That's the word, Bad Company.
Steve DeSalvo, the 290-pounder against the 217-pound Randy Thatcher. We are moving toward the five-minute mark. One fall affair with a 20-minute time limit, and DeSalvo showing his brute strength right now. There is nothing cute about him, either physically, mentally, or as to his wrestling techniques.
I'll tell you what. You can see he is already playing to the crowd. There's that big DDT move. Thatcher could be down for the count, but Strangler Steve DeSalvo has a habit of toying with his opponents. He says there is nobody worthy in this territory of his great wrestling skills, and thus far he is undefeated in the territory in the few weeks he has been back.
He is simply manhandling young Mr. Thatcher. I think he could take him any time he desired, but he'd just like to mess him up a little. And look at that brute strength. And you know, you look at young Thatcher, and he is a well-built young man. But he looks absolutely puny beside the 290-pounder. Little bulldog. Ouch. I could feel that one.
That could very well be it. Thatcher is on Strange Street. The young wrestler out of Regina trying to regain his senses while Strangler Steve DeSalvo flexes the biceps, holds the arms high, plays to the crowd, and takes his time about dispatching young Randy Thatcher. Here's, oh, another big fall. Thatcher in all kinds of trouble. If DeSalvo had any mercy, he would end it and end it quickly. But he is not a man who is given to any display of good feeling or mercy.
He is standing there in the ring and yelling, "Where's LaFleur?" They're at the five-minute mark. "Where's LaFleur?" he says. Funny thing, when LaFleur appears, DeSalvo is running.
Well, Phil LaFleur, the Montreal sensation, he and DeSalvo have a feud going. They're both power lifters. Excellent bodies on the two of them. They're bodybuilders extraordinaire. I will tell you one thing. When the two titans do clash in the ring, it'll be
a sight to see. But in the meantime, Randy Thatcher getting pounded from pillar to post by the big man, DeSalvo.
DeSalvo shows no speed, no technique, no finesse.
Come on, superstar!
Just lumbering bullying. I think that's the way you have to phrase it. And that's what he's doing right now.
Well, the only question is, why does he not end it? Here comes the pile driver. This should be it. DeSalvo delaying, toying, showing a thumbs up sign to the audience, waving goodbye, and now the pile driver. That should be it. Thatcher, one, two, three. Thatcher out. Your winner, and a very unpopular winner, I might add, Strangler Steve DeSalvo.
What an entourage. I can't believe. I'm getting nervous about you.
Don't get excited, King Edward. I'm just sending a message out there to G.I. Josephine, that spineless cockroach who calls himself the North American title holder, that Pee-wee the Hart Herman, and now this other snot-nosed brat who used to broke into this ring here, now he's bringing his nose back here and putting it where it don't belong. That Frenchman, Phil LaFleur. I'm just giving a message that every time I step in the ring, whether I wrestle or I come in my street clothes, I will show you beer belly sharecroppers what Canadian men are all about. They're all spineless yellow cockroaches.
Come on. Come on. Get out of here. What is that?
Not only Canadian, how about Kirshner? He's a disgrace to the whole country of the United States. I can't believe it. I won't even say United States of America. Because you're no American, Kirshner. Yeah. You're a coward. Yeah. You should be a woman. Okay. You should think about getting an operation to make you a woman. Because
oh,
you're a coward.
Oh, come on.
I know, Bellman and Blues, you are afraid of me and Macassing. You don't want to give us a championship match. Owen House, I'm ready for you. Look at the men there. You have gold everywhere. You know what that oil is?
Cute. Very that's cute. Well,
yeah.
Very
don't
cute.
Look
all right. Phil LaFleur, the sensation out of Montreal. He's in there against a young man, I assume he's young, from Buffalo, New York, Black Sabbath. Black Sabbath weighing in at 227, LaFleur 3 pounds heavier, and Black Sabbath attacked LaFleur before anything got going. Look at that power, look at that!
Amazing strength of Phil LaFleur. You see why he is not afraid of Strangler Steve DeSalvo and why DeSalvo has been running from LaFleur. LaFleur, an amazingly, excellently conditioned athlete, he is powerful. Look at this move. Whoa! It could be all over already. One, two, three, it is.
Oh, look at that. Get the official time.
Just 51 seconds. That's absolutely amazing.
Well, there he is. The crowd is chanting Tinkerbell. I apologize. I can't get into the ring. My
Mr.
back
Whelan,
is messed up.
You're a gentleman. You're a gentleman. I appreciate it.
Well,
these cousins, whatever they say, it doesn't matter. I mean, they're cretins, morons. Typical Canadian.
Well, listen, I'm Canadian. Let's get serious here.
You must have been born in the States, Mr. Whelan.
No.
Don't say that, Mr. Whelan, because I'm gonna get sick right here. First of all, Mr. LaFleur, what did he do? 51 seconds?
51 seconds. Wasn't that marvelous?
The Canadian peasant. The best Canadian has to offer is this peasant that LaFleur beat. He beats nobodies. He takes them. Sure, he can beat them. I could beat him in 4 seconds.
Could you beat Black Sabbath in 4 seconds?
Make it three. One clothesline. I put my little toe on him because he's Canada's best, right? He's the best Canada has to offer. Put my little toe on him and just give him that big 26.
I would have to see that.
But you know what?
You're overconfident.
No. Greatness breeds confidence.
Oh.
And this is what I am. And as far as, you know who else I've heard is in the building? The British bull puppies. I'm not quite sure. They must be slithering underneath the chairs like cockroaches. But next, the hearts. That's on my agenda after LaFleur, after I demolish LaFleur. And whoever else they throw in front of me, I'm going to take on the hearts. What do they call him? Omar? Is that his name?
Owen.
He sounds like a disease, too. And then you got Brucey and Pillman, and who else? Who else is
that?
Corporal Kirshner.
Good one. No,
yeah,
Colonel. He's been promoted.
The Vietnamese coward. The one that runs from everyone.
No.
Yes.
But let me tell anyways, Mr. Whalen, I would just like to say, Mr. LaFleur, I'll issue a challenge. I'll take the Black Sabbath on next week, and I'll beat your record by 46 seconds.
46?
I'll give him 5 seconds. I'll let him shine a little bit in the ring. I'll let him walk into the ring. Then I'll close that, and that's it.
One, oh, and what two, if you don't make it in 5 seconds?
Take it to the bank.
All right, I keep telling you that.
Take it and just sell the condos.
How about a meeting with
everything.
Phil LaFleur? That's what I'm trying to get to. How about that?
When that coward signs the contract, but he's
he wants you.
He wants. He runs from me every time.
I think I need my glasses changed. I've seen you with your track
shoes. I keep telling you. How many fingers do I have up, Mr. Whalen?
Yeah, okay.
You got to be blind. I'm telling you. But still, it's a gentleman, and I'm glad you were born in the States.
Yes. Sure.
Phil LaFleur, first off, I must tell you, it was very impressive watching you dispatch your opponent, Black Sabbath, in only 51 seconds. But secondly, I have to say, Ed Whalen was just talking to the big mouthpiece, Strangler Steve DeSalvo. He says he could beat Black Sabbath in 5 seconds, and he also says he doesn't seem to be in any hurry to take you on inside the squared circle.
Well, first of all, that's why I am this way, because of Steve DeSalvo. He's been avoiding me all the time. I've been telling him week in and week out, I've been challenging him, staying away. But he's too scared, he's too much of a coward, and he's staying away from me. But now, it made me so aggressive, this is what I'm doing to all my opponents. And let me tell you, Steve DeSalvo, you think this guy I just beat in 51 seconds, you think you can take him? I bet $1,000 that he can't beat my time. And let me tell you, Steve DeSalvo, I don't know why you've been avoiding me. You claim that you're wrestling's strongest men. You got three things going for you. You got power, you got size, and you're vicious. But I got three things going for me. I got the speed, I got the agility, but most of all, I got the people behind me. And that counts a lot, because when he's slamming me, when he's beating me, kicking me, punching me, and the people goes, don't give up, Phil, that gets my adrenaline going. And before I let a low-life coward like that beat me, you're going to have to knock every ounce of blood out of me.
Well, a feature this time around has to be the Zodiac facing his bosom companion, Jason the Terrible. Let's find out what the Zodiac is thinking about in another studio right now.
Jason the Terrible, you traitorous, hideous, ungrateful, mutant, hybrid specimen of deformities. Now you'll be exposed for what you really are, just another flesh-wielding mortal with an abnormally small brain diseased with the dilemma of popularity. You let our enemy influence you into defying the great Zodiac and Luke, Prince of Darkness. You blatantly disobeyed the oath of the cult and weakened to a mere wilt. I, Zodiac, was the force behind your success and your strength. It was Luke and I who gave you a home and a purpose when everyone else laughed at you and called you names. Now you will pay for your unloyalty and disrespect. Without me as your coach, you are nothing but a deformed mutation of life itself. And that's what the world will witness when I beat you like the dog you are, then unmask you and expose your horribly disfigured features. Then all those fans who you traded for the cult will turn their backs and laugh. Just as they did before.
Bruce Hart, Brian Pillman in action against Kerry Brown at Goldie Rogers. One fall. It's a 30-minute time limit, non-title. And we are pushing toward the 10-minute mark. Bruce Hart going air freight. Brown breaks it up. He has done that on innumerable occasions. The fight has been very much dominated by Hart and Pillman. Bruce Hart getting jammed into the corner.
Hart in all kinds of trouble right now. He's got that ring rope, that tag rope, wrapped around his throat by Kerry Brown. Brown, a former tag team title holder himself. He is loving this. He is exerting all kinds of pressure on the throat of Bruce Hart. And you got to know that referee Jürgen Hermann has to spot this eventually. And maybe he won't.
Kerry Brown going to work. Boy, tell you, when he flies, he can make some rough landings. He took too long. Took too long. Hart beat him at his own game. Shot him down in midair. Now the clothesline and a one count. That's all. Tag, and it's Goldie Rogers.
Well, except for the odd rally, such as we're seeing right now by Goldie Rogers, it has been all Brian Pillman and Bruce Hart, bad company, dominating this bout as we approach the 10-minute mark. And it will take a miracle, I think, if this non-title affair can be won by the team of Goldie Rogers and Kerry Brown.
Just a reminder here, if these are the wrestlers that appear in your town, they are selling wrestling souvenir calendars. Pretty outstanding things. So when you go to your arenas starring these particular wrestlers, well, just have a look-see. I think you'll like them. Goldie Rogers, I don't think he likes Bruce Hart. Here's the tag. Kerry Brown getting set to come in.
10 minutes, Don. 10 minutes.
And we are at the 10-minute mark. Yes, sir.
Kerry Brown staging a bit of a rally. Oh! Bruce Hart got out of the way. Kerry Brown went right into the turnbuckle, and here comes Pillman, taking out his frustrations on Goldie Rogers. Big flying dropkick. Here's a pin. One, two, just a two count. Pillman, a force to be reckoned with in that ring. He's going to do a little noggin knocking.
Bango! Rogers is the object of his disaffection right now. Gives him the big shoulder to the jaw. Pillman looking extremely confident. Well, he has got his pilot's license, all right. He's going to show us his skill right here. Brown breaks it up. That's one of the problems that Jürgen Hermann, or indeed any referee, will have. Trying to keep a big guy like Brown from interfering. Now Brown takes over the assignment, tossing Pillman very close to our laps.
Well, Pillman did take a rough spill onto the concrete, and there's Goldie Rogers pounding away at him at the ringside table, but Bruce Hart gets involved. It's a free-for-all out here.
Well, Pillman having difficulty getting back into that ring. Goldie Rogers going to work now. Can he secure the upset? I don't think he knows that Hart is coming in. Something's got to give here as he got him. Good clothesline.
This could be it. This could be it. Watch this move off the top rope. One, two, three, it's all over. Brian Pillman, an amazing move off the top rope. Cross body block. He gets Goldie Rogers for the count of three. And Bruce Hart keeps Kerry Brown from getting involved.
Guys, a spectacular win. I'll tell you, you have learned something about togetherness, haven't you, as a team?
Yeah, I think that's where it's at in the tag team ranks. You know, certainly we fought a lot of guys who are bigger than us, like Buchan and Kerry Brown, and there's probably some bigger guys on the horizon like DeSalvo and Bad News Allen. So it's really essential for us to get it together and utilize teamwork, or we're probably going to get gobbled by some of these big powerhouses. But I'd like to just say that Brian's probably the best partner I've linked up with yet, and I've linked up with some really good ones in the past. And I think he's an essential ingredient to our championship success.
Well, I think I would concur with that. And Brian, what are you looking at now?
Well, I'd like to comment on what you mentioned, Ed. Teamwork. That's the definite key to our success. You know, a chain's only as strong as its weakest link. And it took a great president of the U.S., Abraham Lincoln, who once said, a house divided against itself cannot stand. And that's been something that we've tried to work on in our workouts, practices, right on down the line. That's why we're building the momentum up, because we stay together. There's been a few times when each of us has some personal problems. The other one was there, stick behind us, lift us up, and the people were there too. And that's one of the great reasons why we enjoy the success that we have.
Okay, a good tag team combination. They do it together. Bruce Hart, Brian Pillman. Owen Hart, Yashiv Khan, Mongolia. Sellout crowd here to take in the proceedings. Oh my. He's showing some Mongolian meanness right now.
A very close attempt at a pin by the Mongolian misfit, Yashiv Khan, but look at that chip up. Owen Hart goes up to greet Yashiv Khan, throws him down. You could call that a superplex, and now Owen Hart is gonna fly.
Well, caught him right on the face. Saw something flying. I don't know whether it's teeth or what, but he caught him right on the face. Now across that ring, look out. Oh, what a landing.
I think that may have been a Mongolian molar. Right out of the jaw of Yashiv Khan. Khan came in exuding confidence. He knew he had about 50 pounds on Owen Hart. Little did he know, he's in there against a whirling dervish.
Up top, pulls him over, nice move. Facing a 270-pounder. You can see the weight means nothing to him. The young man from Calgary, Alberta, Canada. Up top, and there's the landing. Ouch. Oh, did he smack him?
Well, it's very close to being a garbage con.
That's terrible. What was that? Over he comes, 2, 3. Oh, and he bridged beautifully. Beautiful job.
A beautiful bridge maneuver. Owen Hart came off that top rope. He totally surprised Yashiv Khan. A fantastic pin. Well, Owen Hart, some of the big misfits have said you don't like going in there against the big men, the super heavyweights. But it only took you about 7 minutes to make a garbage con out of Yashiv Khan.
Well, you know, he's a respectable opponent. He was Mongolian champion, and he's coming over here to Canada, and he's giving it his best. But he didn't have it enough tonight. I'd just like to say, there's a lot of guys flapping their mouth off, and I've said this week in and week out. All these guys that hear Kerry Brown's challenging me, you know, there's a whole list of them. I'm ready. My knee's almost 100% now. I'm getting better by every match. So any one of these guys want to flap their mouth off, they can come in and take their best shot.
Well, some of these men are big. You're talking about the likes of Bad News Allen, Muck and Singh, but even they, I don't think, can compete with those acrobatic moves that you continue to dazzle us with in the ring.
Well, my biggest disadvantage is my size. I'm smaller than almost 90% of my opponents in the heavyweight division. That includes like Muck and Singh and Bad News Allen, Kerry Brown, Jerry Morrow, Jason, Zodiac, all those guys. So I got to rely on my speed and my quick maneuvers to get me by, and it's worked well for me. If I just keep it up, I hope to retain my North American belt.
Well, it's a pleasure talking to you. A true champion, Owen Hart.
Thank you.
I got to ask you a question, Kerry Brown. Where's Duke Myers?
Well, since me and Duke have been apart, I've been looking for a new partner. As you've seen tonight, evidently, Mr. Hollywood is not it. But there is somebody out there who's got the ability and the stamina, such as myself, to team up with me and take the belts and hold them again for 7 years like we have before. Now, the issue at hand is Mr. Owen Hart. Finally, you brought yourself down to my level, as you would have it, and gave me a match. Well, Mr. Hart, your title reign is probably very, very long for you, but for me, I think it's going to end next week when I take the belt away from you. Now, I'm sorry, I have to do this, but somebody out there has got to step up and stand up for their rights and not sit back and let you push them around like you have been. So, Mr. Hart, you get the Brasso out, you polish the gold and the silver, and you bring the belt. Make sure you bring that little velvet case with it, too, because I want it after I defeat you 1-2-3 next week. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity.
They're grateful. Kerry Brown. It's Kirchner, supposedly against Buckus Singh. Oh, no. And bad news, Allen is interfering at ringside. Wouldn't you know it? I don't believe this. This was to have been a fight between Buckus Singh and Colonel Kirchner. What is going on here at ringside? The yellow stripe business? I can't believe that. The yellow stripe.
Well, for the first 5 minutes of this bout, all Buckus Singh did was run away from Colonel Kirchner. Then a diversion by Bad News Allen. Allen holding on to Kirchner. And you can see Allen is now, he drove him into one of the steel doors. Colonel Kirchner is down. He is hurt. And Bad News Allen, the man that Ed Whalen called his main man, has interfered in this bout, and I cannot believe this.
Now, this is terrible. This is terrible. Buckus Singh did absolutely nothing for six full minutes. Now, the colonel is cut. The colonel is cut. He just keeps getting banged over the head. Courtesy of Bad News Allen. And it's not Buckus Singh. It is not Buckus Singh against Colonel Kirchner. Not at all.
Look at this, Ed Whalen. Look at this.
The what man, are you doing?
The man is a sissy. He made me wait. He shouldn't have never made me wait. I told you before I was going to teach him a lesson.
He would take you face to face, Allen, if you do it one-on-one.
All he has to do is sign his ex on a contract to meet the Ultimate Warrior in the ring, and he hasn't done it. He hadn't did it yet, and he's got me hot now.
What amazes me is Buckus Singh could do nothing. Nothing. Nothing.
It looks to me like Buckus Singh is beating him for everything
he's worth. Because you did it. That's because you did it.
I just gave him a helping hand, that's all. He fell out the ring, and I just threw him back in to help him.
Sure you did. Sure you did. The gospel according to Bad News Allen.
Look at him. Look at him. That's where he belongs. Down on the floor like the lowlife that he is. Look at him. He's gutless. He has no guts. All he did was run from Buckus Singh. That's all he did.
We watched Buckus Singh running for six full minutes away from this man.
I don't know. Bad News Allen must be on some form of mind delusion drug. He has no idea what has transpired in this bout. All he has done is interfere, and he may have cost Colonel Kirchner the victory, because now Kirchner, his head is split open. He is a victim of two-on-one, typical Qureshi vice tactics. It is just absolutely ridiculous. I don't know if Kirchner can recover from this. If anybody can, though, it's the colonel.
Well, he's got a long way to go. And I noticed that Bad News Allen is still hanging around the ring in case the job is not done by the 380 pounds of blubber in there, Buckus Singh.
He's very agile. Kirshner. He won't let him get away, will he, Jim?
Kirshner now has got Muck and Singh where he wants him in a one-on-one fight. Right now, the fight is outside the ring. There's that big headbutt by Colonel Kirshner. He's dragging him around.
Let me get out of here. Or we're going to wind up with a lap full of Mukka Singh, Jim. Out comes the chair. Bango on the back. Bango on the top of the head. I think they're going to... Are they wiping the whole thing out? He says the 10 count has been called. Ring the bell. And it's all over.
It's a double disqualification, but Kirshner is exacting some of the revenge he has been looking for. Muck and Singh fleeing the ring. Colonel Kirshner, I'll tell you what, you were bushwhacked. Once again, it was two against one. You were supposed to be fighting Muck and Singh. He was running from you. Then you had to contend with Bad News Allen. You want to take him on again in a fair and square bout.
Fair and square, nothing, Jim Davies. Look into these eyes. If look could kill, baby, you'd be dead. But I don't want the looks to kill you, man. I want to do it with my own bare hands. Every time, takes two of them, it takes teeth. You see the precious fluid running from this head, man. All I do is see the Red River, and it just makes me hot. I get fired up. I get insane, man. I got ice in my vein and fire in my eyes, and baby, you're going to get burned like a flamethrower at you. Anytime. Next week, Calgary, right here, Mukka Singh. We're talking boot camp, moron. Boot camp. Barbed wire around here, one-on-one. Bring what you want. Do what you want. Anything goes. You can't get disqualified. The only way you're leaving this ring this time is in a body bag. Bring the ultimate moron with you. Bring that wench. Bring the little arrow. Baby, I'm fired up. I'm ready. And this time, there ain't no stopping me.
A boot camp match. Barbed wire around the ring.
There's no way he can come out here and start ordering matches with barbed wire, anything like that. This isn't a concentration camp or something. This is one of the greatest
athletes
in the world. I'll tell you what, if he can get me in a ring, I'm not going to say no to the little punk ever. But I'll tell you what, when I do get in a match with him, bunkhouse match, he's going to wish he was still in boot camp or bunkhouse. I'll tell you something. Your boots ain't big enough to get a boot camp match with me, G.I. Joe. I know where you spent your military career peeling potatoes like some bum.
Yeah, and are you going to stay out of it? That is the question.
What are you talking about? I was just sitting out here minding my own business. But one thing I loved when he had that yellow streak down his back that the good man Mukka Singh put, because that's what he deserves. Wow. G.I. Josephine, a yellow streak.
Let him fight one-on-one, okay? That'll be a change.
He looked kind of nice yellow, didn't he, Eddie?
It's Zodiac all the way right now. The falling star. What? He got the leg up on the rope. Zodiac hit him with a falling star, but didn't put him away.
That is the Zodiac submission hold. He has claimed that no man can get up after going through his falling star maneuver, but Jason proved him wrong. Jason once again avoiding the pin. I'll tell you what, this bout is one heck of a ring ding dong dandy.
Big power slam. Late stages, perhaps, of a match between Jason the Terrible and his former buddy, the Zodiac. They used to work well together. They are working apart now. The flame of love is not burning very brightly here. Look out for this. Zodiac got thrown out. Bango! One, two, three. He got him! He got him! Jason got him! Got him! Got him!
He came off that top rope and slammed into the Zodiac with that fiberglass face mask. It stunned the Zodiac, and Jason the Terrible got the pin. Now, we will see what happens. The loser of this bout is to be unmasked.
Zodiac doesn't want it to be that way. But Jason is going to look after him. He's going to pile drive him. And that's how he's going to get the mask off him. Off comes the mask. I'm not sure what comes out of that mask. Zodiac cannot get away. I wonder if I'll know this man. I don't know him. I don't know him.
I believe that's a wrestler from another territory, Barry O. A wrestler from another territory, and Jason the Terrible has unmasked the Zodiac, and he is strutting around, holding the mask. The crowd is going wild, and here comes Bad News Allen.
What a bizarre night. Bad News Allen comes in to pay a visit.
Calm down, Jason, calm down. I know you don't have too much up here.
Now, Bad News Allen is having a little chat with Jason. I wonder if he's going to congratulate him, because I look in his hip pocket and I see that yellow spray can. I'm a little suspicious.
I'll tell you what, the Zodiac has been dispatched, but now Jason the Terrible had better watch out. As you say, he could be about to get bushwhacked by Bad News Allen.
Jason doesn't quite know what to do. He says, okay, we'll shake hands. There they are. Best buddies, are they really? Oh, no, he put it in his eyes. He put it in his eyes. The yellow's in his eyes. I can't believe that. Is he going to take the mask off him? He's going to take the mask off. No. He's going to use it to go after Jason. Bad News has become his name, hasn't he? Bad News.
This is the horrible influence that you called my main man. I cannot believe it, Ed Whalen.
You've met your Waterloo. You're going in against Jason next week.
Let me tell you something, King Edward. I said that I wouldn't get back in this ring and I wouldn't wrestle until that spineless cockroach, Owen Hart, and that other one, G.I. Josephine, would sign a contract. But this man has got my dandruff up now. He insulted me. I went in there and tried to congratulate him because he got rid of that other idiot, and then he turned on me.
So next week, in the middle of the ring, you're going to see the Ultimate Warrior.
Well, a bizarre scene. I'll look forward to seeing you next time. But in the meantime, and in between time, that's it. Another edition of Stampede Wrestling. Bye, bye, bye now.
Tonight, starting at 6, we've got a lineup of entertainment with a movie show featuring films like Open Glory and Less Than Zero. Then at 6:30, Fashion Television spends a day with fashion reporter Kathy Phillips. And at 7, Calgary consumers got a chance to vote for their favorite Calgary businesses.